That's pretty damning evidence, Mr. Crawford. You want to reconsider?
Absolutely not.
It's going to turn into a circus.
I appreciate your concern for the dignity of the court, 007. Unfortunately, the man is a taxpaying citizen and entitled by our Constitution to try and manipulate the legal system like everybody else.
Have you ever wondered how rich people seem to get away with crimes, major and minor, on so-called technicalities? Not always rich people, maybe gangsters, people of power, or who have access to, you know, the best legal teams or representations, good barristers, lawyers, solicitors, how they get away with it on the technicality. And you think, and you just know that you wouldn't get away with it on a technicality. And you think, God, if you know anything, like, if you know anything about laws, there's the law, and then there's common law. Common law can mean many things, but one of its meaning, in the sense I mean, is case history. Case history further defines the meaning of and the full scope and intent of the law as it was written, and the higher courts have to the lower courts have to implement the rulings of higher courts as to those meanings and so-called precedents as given by higher courts. So you think, wow, these guys are really shit up to know all these precedents and bring them to bear on their cases. My solicitor lawyer wouldn't, I bet, know this. How would I find them out for myself? So many years ago, I tried to look for certain things, and I found that there's many searchable legal databases out there, but they're designed for law firms on a subscription-based payment, so your average Joe Bloggs can't get access to this kind of information. So it seems quite unfair, built into the system, you know. Now, my recent investigations have led me to understand and realize since 1998 we've had the Human Rights Act in our English law, and since then there's been many cases, and there's an open database regarding human rights law concerning judgments in the UK and judgments at Strasbourg, the European Court of Justice. Not that it's searchable for text, but when in the little guide booklets that I have on various sections of law, and on, in particular human rights law, you can actually, when it gives a reference, pull up the complete judgment of the higher court. So when it references something, you can go and read it for yourself, print it out, have a copy, actually substantiate what it says. So this is kind of an information service about how to get off on a technicality, in a way. See, it's common knowledge that the police have to follow procedures, but how in court do you hold the police, for example, to account for failure to follow procedures? you don't have some relevant case history that says this in a similar hearing, you know, the police failed to read you in the America your Miranda rights, in the UK whatever it is, the rights, we get read our rights, say they failed to do that. I think in America that failure can get you off practically any charge. I don't think it does necessarily in the UK, and I'm not I have no idea on that, but it would in many circumstances, I believe, because of human rights law, as more accessible would be and through the case law therein, a separate way to essentially, human rights says in Article 8 in the Human Rights Act, might have a different number in the United Nations articles, but in the English Articles Act, Article 8, it's rather somewhat of a misnomer that it says it's got a little subtitle of privacy, but it's kind of nothing to do with privacy in the sense of in the common sense of the word. It says the citizens are entitled to private and family life, and this isn't privacy as in from view, hidden from view. This is the concept of a citizen as a private entity from government and from governmental control. This is it doesn't state it that way, but it says that a government can only interfere with that right to privacy and family life if it's in accordance with law. And I think it's quite clear that my interpretation is correct of if you examine the case history around what it means for a government to be in accordance with law. It means several things, as evidenced, and I'll probably attach a link to my blog on this matter. But it means most generally, the government can't arbitrarily pick you out and wag its finger at you. Yeah? It must have non-arbitrary rules implemented. So that there's case law then that really establishes synonymously the synonymity of arbitrariness and discrimination. So to act arbitrarily is to discriminate against you as a person. There's a separate article on discrimination which says the government can't discriminate at all. In employment law, there's concrete protection against discrimination on grounds of sex, age, sexual orientation, religion, and perhaps one other. And it seems like, I always seem kind of unfair, like employers actually are allowed to discriminate. Well, of course, if they want to employ you rather than you, that is an act of discrimination, and they think you're the better candidate for whatever reasons they feel. So they have to be entitled to some kind of discrimination, but if they didn't like me because I was fat, say, you know, well, that would be a legal reason in employment law. But so a private company could discriminate like that, but you know, the government can't discriminate on any grounds in principle in human rights law. And it's found in article whatever on discrimination, but it's also embedded in the case law of this privacy article, which is about you as a private citizen as able to live a life separate from government interference, not private as in separate from their view, because clearly every time you meet the government interference, by definition it's public. Yeah. It's no longer in your private life as in out of the view of government. So therein is the wedge to hold to account any government, any UK government organisation. So it's not just the Queen's government, but the Queen's courts, the governmental councils, which are private entities, but work under the governance and implement, law and rules. Local government is an agent of the government. Education authorities, government, health service, all these things are government bodies, and they must deal with you fairly, and they must follow the fair procedures as demanded in human rights, and I don't think it can be argued against. The question is, it seems like a distortion of justice when somebody gets away with something on a technicality. That is the image that's portrayed in the news and TV and such. But if you think and study it hard and imagine what it would be like for you to, on some minor offence, to be taken to task by a government who is essentially acting as they wish, yeah, and not following procedures, the idea is that it's supposed to be more egregious, abhorrent to the senses, that larger notion of the government doing as it wants in any way it sees fit. I think there's something to that. So in my I'm pressing for a judicial review of how I was treated in magistrates court, that I wasn't allowed to petition for a right of audience, a right that I have, not to be granted it, but at least to petition for it and be heard for why it's to be heard on the matter and be given its obligation for me to gain right of audience as a separate entity in court. Is that I have an obligation to convince the judges. But if I'm denied opportunity to even convince the judges by a subordinate clerk of the court, then I am wronged. That's the principal claim that I bring forward. But it's concerning a case of my mother, wherein she littered. She allegedly dropped a cigarette, but there's no evidence of it except this. This one environmental officer who is contracted as a private entity trying to make money for his company. And it begs a lot of issues that littering is a problem, and it's a despicable problem even of littering of cigarette butts. But when somebody is, and I have a huge disdain for smoking and smokers, but it begs the question that which is the bigger problem, cigarette butts or mass littering of toffee papers and outside takeaway bars, the throwing away of wrapping paper from food and such. and it's clearly a more visible and striking problem that, you know, more substantial letter. And it's not pursued very vigorously, that kind of littering, because it's harder to catch. Whereas when people have smoked as a cultural habit for, you know, 40, 50, 60 years, yeah, and part of the cultural habit was to be this, is to drop your cigarette where you stand, you know. It begs a legitimate question of whether part of the human rights law, Jublé, part of the human rights law asks and says, the requirement of the government, if it is to interfere in your private citizenry, private life, that it must be necessary in a democratic society. To, you know, so it begs a legitimate question of whether the correct thing to do is to criminalise cigarette butt dropping, given this situation. And I would say not. It becomes an educational issue and a matter of time, because right, so, but the government did choose to criminalise it. It did pass in law, but mindful of human rights and such, it produced guidance which is enforced in law, that you have to follow the guidance. So my mother had a case where her defence could legitimately be that it was unfair to bring the case because the guy didn't follow anything, didn't seem to, and in court questioning didn't seem to have much knowledge of the guidance, and several features of the guidance weren't followed. So kind of a separate, this is, so I have what the coroner resisting my request for judicial review based on standing that I'm not my mother's lawyer, or I'm not, you know, to think the injustice, major injustice of finding her guilty was against my mother and it's not me, so I have no business pushing on it. But they've misunderstood my case. The whole case for me principally is about this right of audience business. And further, the standing that the clerk of the justice said fairness was of no issue, yeah, because, and I think it's become a common misunderstanding that the idea of a summary offence, because summary offences are these kind of lesser offences which a lower court, magistrate's court, can deal with, rather than Crown Court with a whole jury required. And the idea is the defence of accident is not allowed, for one, for a summary offence. And yet, strangely, it's kind of a defence in the procedures of the law, the regarding littering, that it in the guidelines it says if it's an accident, then you can be given opportunity to pick it up or such. So that there's a conflict there in law between the notion, and I would say the notion of a summary of offence is a general notion which applies except where particular law rule says otherwise. So in this sense, the defense of accident would be available because it's available in the procedure, legitimized in law, in the guidance, legitimized by law. Not that my mum was going to make an argument of accident, but I mean, the very even title of the a summary offence kind of imbues a, look, we're going to find you guilty no matter what. Kind of, you know, this. You hear the word summary execution, you know, it has the feel of, you know, we're going to do what we want sort of thing. So I think there's come this notion that there's no... Anyway, what was said by the clerk to the court was that only matters of fact, material matters of fact, will be considered by the court. Fairness was not under consideration. Now, that is a breach of human rights, for starters, and it's a breach of the court as well, because there's sections in law about the court and that it has to, you know, look to an overriding principle of justice and so on. And then there's evidence procedures that it's bound by which concern the fairness of the evidence. Yeah, there's all kinds of reasons in law why fairness is always an issue in any criminal proceeding, whether it be summary or not. Anyway, in my mother's case, she was given no chance to make any defence. Yeah? It says she did take the stand, but unwillingly and unwittingly, she was directed, though, where in the court procedures, the clerk is supposed to ask you, are you going to be taking the stand, and inform her of her rights, and so on and so forth, all of which didn't happen. So yeah, it's, to my mind, it's a good thing that I find these this piece of open legislation, which demands government agents work according to their own procedures. Another excellent piece of information is the is then following the CPS guidelines for how the government should act. Crown Prosecution Service has an excellent website detailing all the charges, and this has broader implications, because I watch videos about particular one guy in the southern part of England. He has autistic traits, Asperger's perhaps, but he's on the autistic scale. And he likes video recording police, because, like myself, he's suspicious that they don't act according to law. And it's his lawful right to record the police and record anything he likes out in public. But he's been prosecuted several times, and summarily, you know, found guilty without really them listening to his defence. And the fact that in law he's entitled to video record. So this human rights business and government agents following procedures is really important. And it's really important that a tide gets turned and the citizens push back and demand integrity of the government agencies in following their own procedures. And it is more important than many of these fickle, oppressive charges they bring against citizens. Anyhow, just a bit more information. I'll provide links below.
That's pretty damning evidence, Mr. Crawford. You want to reconsider?
Absolutely not.
It's going to turn into a circus.
I appreciate your concern, but the dignity of the court, 007. Unfortunately, You're the man as a taxpaying citizen and entitled by our Constitution to try and manipulate the legal system like everybody else.